I'm going to introduce here some ways and actions to engage stakeholders, and it will be part of a continuation of the presentation of the Patrick and Paula, as well as for the session that was organized here in the morning with the countries. The priorities, it seems to be that we need to access data. We need to ensure that the CMA2 will continue operative after the project life. And we need to ensure that these stakeholders that are providing data or using the data or the products of CMA2 can use an information that is going to be periodically updated in the future. Our idea is that working together, of course, we unify efforts and intent for coastal and marine policies and tools for planning. The active public participation is extremely important. We have been discussing here about those ones that can provide us the data, but citizens are very important regarding, for example, associations or NGOs that are participating there. And of course, involving them facilitate as well the transparency and the interaction with the different groups of the interest. Just to refresh the information that was mentioned this morning, stakeholders are the persons or group who are directly or indirectly involved in the coastal and marine management and planning, those who have an interest in the area, beneficiaries of management policy actions, for example, and groups or persons that they have the ability to influence the outcome, positively or negatively, both of them. Why we need them? We need them because at the end we will have more ideas on the table. We will have different perspectives from the different sectors in the area that we are working in, the coastal and marine area. We will receive more information about concerns that maybe we didn't consider before or when preparing the project. And we will, of course, increase our credibility, the credibility of the project, CMA2, and the chances for the success of this effort. There are different types of stakeholder participation. This is just extracted from the Marine Special Planning Guidelines from IOC. We have horizontal interactions, vertical interactions, different depending on the goal of this negotiation or of this type of interaction, we will have different outputs. The negotiation to reach a decision, that is important as well for the data providers. Consultation to determine a common position in a member state, for example. Dialogue to develop understanding, because of course the stakeholders need to understand what we are doing first. Consultation, information, communication, etc. We need to consider as well not only the type of engagement, just the degree or the and the intensity of engagement of the stakeholders, because depending on this, we will receive more inputs to our project or not. And for this, we need a strategy that we need to think, we need to plan, and we need to manage in order to organize and consider all the different tasks that this will be the output of this presentation and to integrate them into the work agenda of this project. How to start? I think you have done already in the previous section this exercise to strategically and prioritize the different stakeholders in your countries. As you see there, type of stakeholders that are mandated by law, I mean that the government agencies affected by your project decisions, for example, hotels in the small island states that they are representing the most important economic activity in the country, most interested persons in our activities, maybe it could be research centers, and that they are developing information with their own research. And maybe this information is or data is not available at national level. Most relevant for our activities by sector, we have mentioned here those industries that can affect the water qualities or LMEs, the scale of governance as well, not only the national level, also regional and local. involve them at the earliest convenience. This is one of the suggestions, and define the optimal sequence of the engagement. And this is why we think that the best practice involved the increase of transparency or the fluent communication to promote first the understanding about the project, but also for the stakeholders to know which kind of inputs we need from them, but how we are going to use them. And this is important as well to keep the communication and the fluid communication with them. How to approach them? There are many ways to approach the different stakeholders. Consultation is essential, following the types of engagement that I just shown at the beginning. Using basic principles of good practices, of course, incorporating their feedback, even if it's positive or not, and document the process and the results of the consultation, because this will help us as well at the end of the project to know how we have been interacting with them. And one important thing is that we need to engage them in all kind of activities. I mean, we need to contact them periodically, saying, okay, your inputs, we are using it in this part of the Atlas, or it will be helpful if you can improve your contribution and review your contribution in a specific report. Invite them to activities that you are organizing in your country, etc. How to do it? It's through participatory tools, mainly. There are different techniques and methods. Of course, here we can spend one day discussing about this. But there are the ones that you already know, participatory workshops, face-to-face meetings to define the role that of the each stakeholder, interviews, local institution analysis to sit in the same table different stakeholders and decide which contribution they could do, and also to identify jointly the different issues and with the possible solutions in the context of the project. Of course, we need to understand the each stakeholder as a partner of our national working group. And this, I insist, we need to do it in a fluent way, but also in a transparent way, involving them since the beginning of the project. Now is the time to do the work, to define the common objectives and the strategic interests for all the parts, to use these participatory approaches that I just mentioned, and always document the outcomes. Once that we have the stakeholders contributing to the project, it is important to monitor as well their own involvement. I believe that this is a good opportunity to identify if they have lack of capacities, because if the project itself in the country or at regional level are organizing trainings, they could be invited and be participants of this, promoting this participatory monitoring that they could monitor and they could update their own data sets that they are creating. In many cases are statistical databases, in, for example, the hotels with the tourists and clients. And as well to promote this capacity development in terms of data production that is important for us and the management of the environmental monitoring. About the reporting and communicating, how to report and communicate the work progress and the identification of these new needs, I just mentioned it. You will need to decide how frequently you are going to do this. But one important thing is that here, for example, we are using only one language. But since the beginning, since the first day, we know that in not all your countries you speak English. Then the information need to be address to stakeholders in their own national language and translate the information if needed for them to be involved in the process. And then my last slide is this one, because with this information and also the information that was reported from the two different groups this morning, we need to translate all of this into specific project activities. And from my point of view, I will not ask you to make questions. I'm not specifically an expert on stakeholder involvement or engagement, but I think it could be a nice way for you to contribute, and country per country, to say, to identify some specific task on how to integrate all of this information into the work agenda and the project activities. Then if you agree, and if the Mr. Arias give me the authorization, we can go one by one per country, and at least to few minutes.
Yes, no problem. I believe it's the moment to begin to put things of the kind in the meeting. And yes, if you feel comfortable with that, everybody that. Please.
Could you please start, Ramon? What do you think? Specific task activities that we could include in the project work agenda, specifically regarding this engagement of stakeholders?
Do you just want me to speak at the national level?
Yes.
At the national level, one of the key things we need to accomplish, especially for the second phase of the CMA, because we're trying to reach more than just the technical stakeholders that we reached on the CMA one. I think one of the key areas we need to do is, well, first, after we identify the priority areas that we're going to focus on in terms of the environmental management issues that we're trying to address as part of the system, is to identify not only the particular stakeholder agencies, say, or groups involved in the process, but also their particular or how they interact with other groups as part of the policy cycle. So there has to be some kind of understanding of their requirements for communication. So both with how do people before them in the policy cycle need to communicate with them, and how do they need to communicate with the people after them in the policy cycle. So if there can be some kind of activity which will take a holistic look at the particular needs of the particular agencies or groups involved in those different spaces of the policy cycle, I think that would go a long way to determine what tools need to be developed as part of the Atlas program to address those specific needs. Is it going to be that they require just information products, brochures, pamphlets, or some kind of like short report, or are they going to be that they require, because they're at a technical level, that they require the data which will actually go into generating those reports, and then that's how they'll pass on that information to the next phase of the policy cycle. So basically just has to be an assessment of the specific information reception and delivery needs of those particular groups involved in different phases of the policy cycle, or a specifically identified national priority issue.
Thank you very much. Mr. Azueta from Belize.
Yeah, to add what Ramon said, I think once the information has been packaged and it's very clear the way it's going to go, I think it should be incorporated in ongoing, like for example, campaigns. In Belize, we have 3 going right now. There's one on protected areas, increase in replenishment zones, and managed access for fisheries. I mean, these people are out in the field working with all the stakeholders. Mm-hmm. But if we have the information for CMA 2, we can incorporate that. Thanks.
La señora Sierra Correa, de Colombia.
No, estoy aquí. I'm fast.
Costa Rica. ¿Algún comentario sobre cómo se podría plasmar en la agenda de trabajo nacional de Costa Rica esta involucración de los actores principales en vuestra costa?
Nosotros, digamos, lo que hemos estado tratando de hacer son como comisiones regionales, donde están los principales actores por región, ¿verdad? Lo que pasa es que a veces la información no baja como en la línea que uno como que se quiere, ¿verdad? Entonces cuesta mucho el poder involucrar.